That's going to be kind of hard to follow, I think. But if somebody can do it, I think that's Dina from OSP, who has the unenviable position of speaking first. So once again, these are lightning talks. So Dina will have 10 minutes to tell you everything about the policy relating to dbGaP, right?
10 minutes, okay.
There we go. All right. So, and we should have time for a couple of questions, Dina.
And Mike left me to do some of the statistics. So I have to cover some of that in my talk. But the title of the talk is dbGaP at the Intersection of Policy and Research. And this has really been a very fruitful collaboration. We have weekly meetings, Office of Science Policy, with NCBI, and they've been great. We work well together, and it's just been a very important collaboration to move all of this forward. So as you know, there are many benefits of data sharing. Data sharing enables data generated from one study to be used to explore a wide range of additional research questions. We know that one study team that's generating the data cannot possibly answer all the questions in that data set. It increases statistical power and scientific value by enabling data from one study to be combined with another study. It facilitates reproducibility and the validation of research results, and also facilitates the innovation of methods and tools for research. Much of the requests coming in to use dbGaP data are focused on statistical methods development. NIH has a long culture of data sharing. This is really nothing new. But for today, we're going to be focusing on the genome data sharing policies, the GWAS policy, and the GDS policy. So the NIH genomic data sharing policies were developed to set forth expectations and responsibilities to ensure the timely, broad, and responsible sharing of genomic data, and for human data, that would happen in a manner that's consistent with the informed consent of the study participants. And as I mentioned, we've had two data sharing policies reflecting this, the 2007 GWAS policy, and also the 2014 genomic data sharing policy. And for human genomic data that's generated as a result of being funded under these policies, unless the informed consent explicitly indicates that the data should be shared in an unrestricted or public access repository, the expectation is that the human genomic data and the associated phenotypic data should be registered and deposited and accessed through the NIH Database of Genotypes and Phenotypes, dbGaP. So this is a really brief overview of the process that I wanted to remind everyone that's in place. And we heard from Mike about the DUCs and the DARs and the DACs and the GPAs, and all of that is reflected here somehow. So on the data submission side, for those individuals, investigators that are generating large-scale genomic data, at the time of the data submission, the institutions also inform the NIH what the appropriate uses are for that data. They also submit what's called an institutional certification, which is an assurance that the data can be shared and how it can be shared. The data is then registered in dbGaP, which is the repository for the human data, and all the HIPAA identifiers are removed. There are two kind of aspects or tiers to dbGaP, the unrestricted access part and the controlled access part. And the unrestricted access, that's where we have our study protocols and other descriptive information. And then controlled access is where we have the individual level genotype and phenotype data, as well as the summary statistics because of Homer, which was mentioned. So under the data access side, for all those individuals who are interested in accessing the data, they must submit a data access request or a DAR. Those requests are co-signed by the institution, and they agree upon the terms of access, which are specified in the data use certification agreement, also called the DUC. And then the PI agrees to a code of conduct that they won't transfer the data, that they'll only use it for the purposes indicated in the application, that they won't attempt to re-identify individuals. Those requests are then reviewed by the Data Access Committee, also the DAC. And the Data Access Committees are mostly reviewing these data access requests for consistency with the data use limitations that were specified by the submitting institution. And if if the requester is granted access, then they will then be able to access the controlled access data. So these are some of the statistics. So right now, NIH institutes and centers are sponsoring about 850 studies in dbGaP. And the percentage of sponsorship is indicated on the left. So NHGRI, NHLBI, and NCI have the most studies in dbGaP right now. For the data set, for these 850 studies, studies in dbGaP. There have been over 49,000 data access requests that have been submitted. 33,000 of those have been approved, and over 1,500 publications have actually been produced as a result of accessing this data. There have been over 5,000 PIs requesting access to the data from 46 countries, and for these studies in dbGaP, we have over 1.5 million participants represented. And I'd also like to point out that at the beginning, there was a learning curve for everyone. You can see in the lower right figure that in 2007, we had our first request coming in. And you can see that there was an increase in the number of requests from 2007 to 2016. But what I wanted to point out is really the red curve showing the processing time for the data access committees. We were at about close to 65 days for just being able to process a data access request at the very beginning. But we're now down to less than 15 days. And so that really shows that we've all been able to work together to be able to process the request rather quickly, and we know a little bit more about what we're doing now. There have been several improvements to dbGaP over the years, and this is really the policy and technical collaboration. We just because there's an improvement made doesn't mean that the policy is necessarily separated from that. We have to work very closely together to be able to move everything forward. We've standardized forms, we've developed standard data use limitations to promote consistent implementation of consent group categories, we've created search filters, we've assembled data collections, we've added facts and figures for transparency so that anyone can go to the NIH GDS website and see how many requests there are, see how many data sets are in the system. And we've also developed a dbGaP data browser. But the two items I have highlighted is what I wanted to just briefly mention in a little bit more detail. And that's we've explored innovative solutions for storing and sharing of data through the establishment of trusted partners, and that we've also developed a process to allow approved users to store and analyze data on a cloud computing platform. So an NIH Trusted Partner is an external organization that's able to meet the core NIH standards for establishing data quality and data management services for NIH. Trusted Partners are essentially an extension of dbGaP. So any organization that's established as a Trusted Partner must meet the same policy and technical requirements that dbGaP meets. Establishment of Trusted Partners is based on the programmatic need of an NIH funding institute or center and is only established through an IC's contract mechanism. And the core standards for establishing a trusted partnership are in five categories: data submission, data storage, data distribution, data security, and stewardship. There are several models for trusted partners. There's a mirror image model, a unique data storage, and a value added. Many of the trusted partners are in the value added category because they're offering something that's not available through dbGaP. So they can access the data, but then they may be offering some sort of analytical sort of tool that's not in the system. All of the established trusted partners right now are through the National Cancer Institute, including CG Hub, BioNimbus, the Cancer Genomics Data Commons, and also the Cancer Genomics Cloud Pilot Project. So when dbGaP was first established, there wasn't really much thought or anticipation of the use of the cloud. But after the system was up and running, we started to receive a lot of input from the community that we don't want to just download this data on our servers. The data sets are becoming very large. Can we somehow transfer this data to the cloud? And so we worked closely together to develop a position statement on the use of cloud computing services on dbGaP data. And to do that, to support the appropriate and secure use of the data, we had to update a lot of documents. We had to have a lot of meetings to ensure that the process would still protect the participants whose data was being accessed. So we had to update the NIH security best practices document, the data use certification agreement, and also stress the important role of the institutional IT director. And investigators interested in using the cloud for analysis and storage of the data must also indicate this in their data access request. So this slide just reflects how many data access requests we've had that have indicated that they're using the cloud, and that's about 500. dbGaP has also played a very important role in the HeLa genome sequencing policies that we have. Per the agreement in 2013 between NIH and the LAX family, NIH requests that all researchers apply for access to HeLa whole genome sequence data through dbGaP. We have a working group that operates a little bit differently than a standard data access committee because there are two members of the LAX family on this committee, and because of that, we go through the advisory committee to the director, and the NIH director actually makes the final decision on these projects. But we have two policies related to this, and we work very closely with NCBI to develop the appropriate process to access these data. And there have been 67 requests in place to access the data, 55 of which have been approved by the NIH director. So I'd like to thank other staff and OSP for contributing and working hard and shedding blood, sweat, and tears to get all of this done, as well as all the NCBI staff, but especially those who we work with closely on a daily basis, as well as all the NIH genomic data governance committees, and Laura Lyman Rodriguez, who was also one of the pioneers of this effort. And so with that, I thank you.
If there are any questions, if you'd want to jump up to one of the mics in the middle. I have a quick question. So the DAC processing time graph, can I extract that from your presentation and tweet it out?
Yeah.
Awesome. All right, cool. So thank you. Any questions for Dina? All right, well, thank you again.